Okay. Yeah, a lot of celebrities. Whew. And you see that football footage? That was my boy, All-State, Iowa, played at Northern Iowa. That's the important credentials here. I know Emmy Awards and stuff, but, you know, played his college football and did his damage in Iowa on the gridiron. Let's bring him in. Mark Steines. What's up, Mark?
Hi, Denny. Oh, hang on 1 second. I just want to make sure we're doing this correctly. I don't want to.
Yes.
Do I need to wear this?
Yes.
It's really hard. You know, I wanted to thank Carlos, but I can't quite. I can't.
Well, we can still hear him.
Yeah, I got it caught in my ear. By the way, a shout out to my mother-in-law who made these fabulous face masks for the entire family. So we're all safe and we're good. But that was quite an intro you put together. Wow.
I would like to think I put it together and I would like to take credit for it, but I didn't. And so, but I will. I'll still take credit for it, Mark.
Right. Okay. Well, I love the music. I love the music. Yes, you here. Yes.
Okay. Because Mark in the LA area. Is or received the VIP package from Casablanca, our guests seem to like it.
Can I take a moment?
You can do it.
Casablanca, we were just there in November for my son's 16th birthday, my two boys, and I went out, and it was one of the best, because I'd been gone there for years, it was one of the best bonding moments we had because the service was great. I love the tequila cart that comes by. Of course, they're too young to have that, but they'll make any kind you like, whether you want something sweet, which I tend to kind of go for more sour or something that doesn't have a lot of sweetness to it because I always get a headache afterwards. But it is fantastic, and that's fresh tortillas, and the food is wonderful. So thanks for sending that over, and thanks for sending the margaritas over. Carlos, thank you. And I drive by there constantly because I'm always heading from this way down towards the beach doing something or another. Well, not recently because we're all locked in, but anyway.
Yep. Love it, man. So Carlos got his sound clip. We can move on from Carlos at this point. Okay. I used to coach him when he was a kid. And he was quite the athlete. He was, really? He was quite a player. Yeah. I got to give him props. Okay. We talked enough about Carlos. You know, that brought up a question, Mark, would you prefer your lower third there to be Emmy Award winning broadcaster, or would you prefer it to be All-State running back, Hempstead High School, Iowa?
Oh gosh. You know what? I never dreamed of becoming an Emmy Award winning broadcaster. That was just something that was, in my opinion, came from the hard work I put in on the gridiron, of which where I did dream of becoming an NFL football player. Of course, who doesn't? When you're kind of going down the path I was as a kid, you dream of those big days, those touchdowns, even the Super Bowl. How dare you? But I grew up watching football and playing in the backyard. Right. And then, when I was in high school, we had 3-a-day workouts. And it was commitment. And I wasn't fortunate enough to make it to state, but my brother's team, which he's 2.5 years older than me, made it to state championship. They made the Iowa State championship. They lost, and then the following year, they went and ended up winning the whole title. And I don't think they've won since. So as far as getting back to the playoffs, I made it to the playoffs my junior year. My senior year, we didn't. But
isn't it something? Every state has its own unique way of approaching high school football and the like, but it's such a slice of America. We know we have a series that's going to come up on here about Madison High School. It's Northeast Ohio, and just how that town rallies around their high school football team. And we know, California and Florida and Texas provide, these talent, but Iowa, Nebraska and stuff, and what every state has such a great feeling towards high school football. And, you talk a little bit about playing in Iowa, like what was unique to playing in that state?
What I liked about it is, there are a lot of, we call us corn fed, there were some guys with some real grit that came through the program at Northern Iowa, even in our high school. But if I go on to UNI, I could put on my UNI hat. I got it somewhere here. In fact, the head coach, Mark Farley, who is there currently, the head coach has been there, I think, approaching 20 years, he was my roommate. He was an inside linebacker. He was a walk-on from walk-on Wisconsin, and came. I remember he came in. He was so skinny and just wanted it so badly. The second year he came back into the program, he hit the weight room. He bulked up and he continued to get big and played inside linebacker for us. And the guy was a bruiser, and now he's coaching, and he's gone to the national championship with you and I and played Appalachian State. I think it was several years ago, but continues to be ranked in the top probably eight to five. But you see these, like Carson Wentz came from my division, and, you know, he's led Philadelphia. I mean, he's an unbelievable player. I played with a football player named Bryce Pop, who came from a program that was so small. It wasn't from Iowa. I think he was from either Missouri or Illinois, but his team was so small that they didn't count the guys on the field to see if they had 11. They counted the sideline to see if they had four. And he went both ways, but he goes on to become, from that small program, he goes on to become a defensive player of the year in the NFL.
Yeah.
And I'm just so proud to be a friend of his. And he's now, I think, coaching in Minnesota.
So you're primarily a running back. I'm sure you had to play both ways, at your high school, or they at least, you know, squeeze you up for all you were worth. But then at Northern Iowa, you played primarily defense and moved to the outside backer. Is that right?
Well, they did. I didn't actually play both ways in high school. We had a pretty good size program. I played actually on defense. I was a nose guard. Ooh. And I resisted that position because I saw myself as a fullback. But my coach, Bob Timmerman, was so smart. He knew that I had the speed and the lower leg strength to get around people. And I don't know if I led the team in sacks, but I know I had a lot of fun sacking quarterbacks. Oh, wow. Okay. Then my senior year, I moved over, and it gave me a lot of because I had a really good fullback starting that year, and so I would have been playing backup. So it was a way to get me on the field. But when I got to college, you know, it was a different ball game. They loved the speed that I had. They liked the size that I was carrying, and felt like, you know, they had enough in that category. So they said, "Look, this guy likes to hit." So they put me on defense, and I played outside linebacker, and I loved it because we played in two-man coverage. We would go out and be locked up on the receiver with help over the top. We'd also have to, you know, be accountable for sweeps, so you're going against a pulling guard. So there were a lot of times, like, you had to carry your weight very well and had good speed. I was 4'6", 40 when I played, ran track, which helped my speed. Now I think I'm 64. In the 40, that's 64 seconds.
Yeah, I was going to say, yeah. Yeah, I was able to break 6, I think, in the 40 after a few tries in high school.
Yeah, there you go.
But I can long snap, so I made up for it.
Oh, you know, there you go.
That's a very specialized position, as you well know, Mark.
Yeah, very much.
Yes. Very much so. So I wanted to, first, before I bring something up, what do you got going on behind you on your shelf there? What do you got?
Oh, over here. Oh, yeah. Here. I'm sorry. You didn't see it. You know what? It's weekly cleaning. I take down the Emmys every day, you know, week. I polish them. Typically don't do that anymore. I have my children do it as a reminder of just who they're living with.
This is what success looks like, buddy.
I put that there. By the way, I put that there just for you. You know,
that's great, because when I had Boom Boom Mancini on the show, he showed off his lightweight world title belt, and Tim Leary showed off his 1988 World Series ring. And I wanted to just make sure this was recognized yet again. This is the 1986 championship trophy. Tony Lennon, shout out for the Venice Backyard Championships, most prestigious of all backyard volleyball tournaments ever. So I just wanted to make sure I got that into the clip there.
I will say this, I have, and I was going to do this but I didn't know. I have a World Wrestling Federation belt, championship belt, with my name on it. But I was, because I was a moderator for a panel, because they'd gone over to serve the troops, and they did a documentary, and we had a viewing of the documentary, and then I moderated. So they gave it to me as a present.
Wow,
but my kids found it, and they're like, "Dad, why didn't you tell us?" And I go, "Shh." I was like, I didn't know what to say in the moment. I go, "Shh, don't say anything. You cannot tell anybody you found this." And they're like, "Why?" And they're very small at this age. But they knew enough. And I'm like, "Listen, if anybody finds out, they'll want to fight me, because I'm the champion." So I said, "Do not tell anybody."
They're like, "Okay." Nice. My kid, when he was little, you love wrestling so much. He used to put on a Hawaiian shirt and open it up, and want me to introduce him into the room and call himself Tropical Storm. He made that up. I was like, very entertaining. That was a good time. Hey, I was going to ask you how you got started in the broadcasting game, but my crack staff I said crack staff. I didn't say the reverse. That they found this, and so check this out, Mark. This is fun.
Paul Hogan lashes out at the tabloids.
Who caused the biggest stir at the Republican convention?
Things are scary again on Elm Street.
And what did Woody do before being admitted to the bar at Cheers?
Entertainment Tonight for Friday, August 19th, 1988, slips you a Mickey.
This record will self-destruct when it reaches the final groove.
The presence of Tom Cruise behind a news camera at the Republican National Convention caused an uproar until it was discovered that it wasn't Tom Cruise at all, but an incredible simulation. He came from a local television station in Iowa, one of just many TV cameramen covering the Republican convention. But he was spotted at a restaurant, and the owners tipped off the Times-Picayune that Tom Cruise was in town. Perception became reality, and suddenly, everyone was assuming that 24-year-old Mark Steines was star Tom Cruise.
Oh my God, he's gorgeous! We just hope he's here as a Bush supporter!
And how did Steines feel about all the attention?
Terrified, terrified. It was incredible. let's go to another bar.
What do you have?
What do you got?
As the real Tom Cruise is busy playing bartender, the Tom Cruise lookalike was discovering some disadvantages.
I'm glad I'm not Tom Cruise. I'd put it that way, because you can't go anywhere.
But he did have a request about his likeness.
I'd love to meet him. Someday, maybe. Someday. Call me. We'll get together.
Steines' uncanny resemblance to Cruise may be just what he needs to launch a dream of becoming a sportscaster. A reputable talent agency in New York is very interested.
Okay. That's hilarious. A 24-year-old. Look at that. That's something. Yeah.
That I'll tell you, I tried for so long. I was a cameraman, as you saw, for so long to get a career in sportscasting, because my football career ended with a blown out knee and ACL, and I was done in my senior year. And I was like, well, if I can't do this, I'm going to talk about it. And I wanted to get into in front of the camera, and I tried as hard as I could, and nothing worked. And then I went to the 1988 Republican National Convention. You saw the story there. Mm-hmm. And a week later, I had three job offers and come in. And I decided to go with the one in Springfield, Missouri, KSPR-TV, Channel 33, because they're in the conference. Okay. At the time, the Southwest Missouri State Bears. Now it's, I think it's Missouri State.
Yeah.
And, but regardless, that helped get my career off the ground. You know, remember, Denny, back then at that point, there was no reality television, because that's where a lot of people use that as a launching pad, because they have such notoriety, whether it's Big Brother or whether you're on Bachelor or Bachelorette, you have all these opportunities to now create a massive social media following, if you will, and get on all these TV shows. And if you've got that spark, people are looking for that, and that didn't exist. So when this aired, and Entertainment Tonight was huge, especially back then, it was, you know, an opportunity for me. And then almost seven years to the day that aired, that I got hired by Entertainment Tonight.
Which is such a trip. I'd be remiss to forget that we're the top video podcast in the Sentinel Adobe Corridor.
Congratulations.
We've created that big break for ourselves here. Now, I want to ask you some. Any regrets on not just sticking to being a Tom Cruise impersonator? Because think of the career you could have had there.
I'm going to tell you something that I've never told anybody else before. I actually was hired out once to attend a party of celebrity lookalikes for Sam, the owner of Sam's Club. I think it was Walton.
Yes.
And it was up in Missouri, Columbia, and they paid to go up, and I show up in the whites and just mingled around with everybody from Radar, from MASH to Vanna White and whatnot. And, got back in my Honda CRX and drove on home. There's more to that story, which I'll keep off the airwaves, but It was phenomenal. I'm like, I've never done this before, but that was the first and only time I went down that path. And there's enough Tom Cruises in the world. We have to have at least one Mark Steines.
was that like 88, 89 range right around there?
Would have been, yeah. It was right. Yeah. I'm telling you, in New Orleans, I had senators approaching me, asking me to flip bottles for them, you know, from cocktail, or they would come up and just dive into like, you know, I was in the service and I flew Hornets and I did this and that. And I'm like, yeah, me too. What a journey. They would not take no for an answer. They just kept believing it. But I've had that lookalike thing since The Outsiders came out, and kids that I went to school with, high school, they're like, dude, you're in this movie. And I'm like, what? But Tom's doing fine, and I'm sure he has no clue who I am. So,
yeah, I made a handsome living going out as John Elway for a while until they asked me to play football, and then it fell apart on me. So tell me a little bit about climbing through the ranks of sportscaster. You go from, you know, behind the camera to in front of the camera. So you got that break. And how did that lead eventually to Los Angeles, where I think that's where we originally met, was when you were at KCAL and you came down to cover a pro beach volleyball tournament that I was like the stage announcer or something. And which is weird because I liked you because you were smart enough to go to me. You went, I know who probably knows who the best players are. And like so many media people, they ask all the wrong people. Like you went, that guy must know. You're right. Cause I call all the games. Yeah. So you came over to me, you go, who are the best players? And so that was just kind of funny that we originally met that way. But tell me, how did you make your way from Missouri to LA?
Great question, by the way, Denny. My journey started off by me going out on an audition in San Diego and tanking. I flew in to audition for this job that it was only the second news desk I ever sat on as a sportscaster, but I felt so comfortable and really polished my skills in Springfield where I wasn't afraid to make mistakes. But as soon as I got there, I was just nervous. Like, this job is amazing. Look at the city, and we're going to be doing professional sports. And I forgot to bring me to the audition. And I called my agent when I got back to the hotel room and I said, man, I just was awful in this and it's terrible. And he said, listen, I wasn't going to tell you this, but KCAL Channel 9, Beth Meharry, they've been looking at your tape. They really like you, but they're not going to fly you in for this job. It's a sports reporter's job. Why don't you reroute your flight and go up to LA? So I was just self-hatred. I was like, I'm better than this. So I get up here, stay at my buddy's house. We drive in. We broke down on the freeway, getting down to the 10 freeway to get off in La Brea. We make our way, which was at Paramount Studios. So now I'm walking into Paramount Studios on Hollywood, where KCAL was located. And I'm just in awe of this. And they're like, oh yeah, they're shooting in where they used to shoot I Love Lucy. You know, and I'm like, this is blowing my mind. But I still walk in, I meet with Beth. And, you know, she tells me the job, and it's just a sports cast. It's not just, but it's sports reporting only. There's no anchoring. And I looked her, and this is probably, and I don't know if I would have done this before, but I just felt like I needed to regain that composure that I felt I lost. I just looked her in the face and I said, listen, thank you so much for this opportunity. I'm going to have to say no, because I cannot afford to take myself out of that cockpit, so to speak, out of that chair of anchoring. I said, I'm going to get here and I'll be a sports, you know, director perhaps one day in Los Angeles. I may have to go through Denver or Dallas or Phoenix, wherever it may be, but I will be here. Mark my words. And shook her hand. I left and flew home and thought that was it. A week later, they came back with an offer on the table where they were going to give me one night, Saturday nights. Okay. And I took it. I was like, I'm going to take this opportunity. And I flew here. And there was a moment, by the way, there's a moment that I shared with people in the past, where I was driving home to Santa Monica down the 10 freeway. And at KCAL, we carry the Laker games back then.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
And I always remember when I was out, you would see it on in a bar or whatever, and they would just leave the game on. And I was just driving home kind of thinking, you know, because our show comes on right after the Laker game. And I thought, maybe it's just somebody at home was watching and they just left it on and they went and got a sandwich and came back. And it hit me that Johnny Carson lives here. And I watched Johnny Carson as a kid growing up in Iowa, knowing that he had Midwestern roots. And I all of a sudden, like, just this epiphany hit me that I gotta step it up. Like, I'm on a stage now where anybody can see me. So that's when all of a sudden I'm like, Johnny Carson could have watched me tonight. Talk about a role reversal. And that's when I was like, you know what? You got to show up every single day. And this is why I go back to what you're saying before about football. What title I prefer is that I went back to what it was like to being an athlete, where you have to show up, you're a team player, you have to dig in and dig hard, and find the stories and find the things that are really going to put you out there in front of people. And
no doubt.
Yeah.
Yeah, no doubt. And, you know, on some nights you're following Chicky Baby and the Showtime Lakers, or, you know, probably the post Showtime Lakers, but still, like, Chick Hearn was such an institution in the city.
Yeah.
And like, you know, you're coming on and you're the sports guy. So that's gotta be something. Now, you know, you mentioned Midwest roots, and I gotta show you something, because I was looking into your file.
Oh no.
And I saw this picture of you in high school, football. And I thought to myself, did Mark play in the 1950s? Like, what happened here? This is what I would look up in, like, Guinness Book of World Records, and then some football player would just be jumping up in the air, and you don't even know what position they played when they did this. I mean, look, we got Wayne Boley on our video podcast right now, and he actually played in the 1960s as a player, and okay, what's the difference here? Like, that's Wayne Boley, right?
Yeah.
And then you look at your football picture. Who possibly could have staged that in the 1980s with you?
I'll tell you where that picture was taken. Is, I believe it was, they did a feature on me, the local TV of the local paper, the Dubuque Telegraph Herald, and the photographer came out and just said, you know, jump up in the air for me. And I was like, okay.
Sure. Because I do this all the time at nose tackle. Yep. This is what my coach wants me to do. You know, you think he wants me to get low. He doesn't.
That's what I'm doing.
That's hilarious. Okay. I just had to have some fun with that. So Mark, one of the great things, is, you know, we'd bumped into each other and so on and so forth. But what happened was, when I caught back up with your career after, I faded out of Entertainment Tonight, I have to say. And then, at some point, you're doing the Rose Parade, and I was like, what the heck? That is so cool. Like, 'cause the Rose Parade and the Rose Bowl are such a point of pride, not just for the city of Pasadena, but for Southern California and beyond, because it's this way that on January 1st, we show off to the rest of the country just how great our weather is, why we put up with all the traffic, you know, and why we put up with everything else, because everybody else is frozen under and they go, holy God, look at that. And it's just so beautiful and inspiring. So before we chat a little bit about that, I want to show you something. My wife and I, Christine, we got to go to 2018 and go to the parade and then go to the football game. So we're just going to roll that. It was the last game of Urban Meyer's career, which was also kind of cool to see him coach his final game. So here's just a couple of things from that. In case you didn't recognize my voice, that was me going, America, because I get kind of fired up when I see fireworks and a stealth coming right overhead.
Oh, boy, it is bomber is amazing. It's an amazing thing to see, because it arrives before the sound does, you know? Yeah. And when we're doing the parade, funny thing happened this particular year, but I try to turn around in my seat because it's coming behind us. And I'm trying to see it off in the distance because we try to time it. And I would put my leg underneath me, and Lisa was sitting next to me. And I turned around, and to this point, I don't think she'd know. Well, maybe I shared this with her. I started getting a cramp in my hamstring so bad. And we weren't on camera, but I could not stretch my leg. And I pulled all of my cables out, microphone comes out, and we're seconds away from going live for millions of people around the world. But that's what, to me, it's like, oh, I have to see that. I mean, between that and the blimp, phenomenal views. It's just something to be able to grasp. You get it. I mean, come on, when that went over your head, Denny, didn't you just feel the hair stand up on the back of your neck and your arms?
Absolutely. And we're so fortunate where we were, as you can see where we were, you get that backdrop of the mountains and that beautiful rose color that settles in. That's football that, you know, that's by the time the game comes on. Yeah. And it's just gorgeous. I mean, we're fortunate in that in different stadiums, like Dodger Stadium at sunset is so beautiful, but nothing like the Rose Bowl. And that Rose Parade too, it's a little crisp in the morning. It's one of those few days of the year that you actually get a little, like, you know, what we call cold, what the rest of the country calls, you know, summer weather. But we get that, and that's in the, you guys, it always kind of cracks me up to look at you and Lisa Gibbons in the booth, and you know, you got on some coats, and so you're like you're playing the part, but you could really go with like a windbreaker.
Well, we do. They used to have electric blanket on our laps, but I passed on that. I was like, it's just too much, you know. I just wear Uggs and some jeans, and I have those little. It does get cold. It was the last 2 years driving. It was like down to 38 and 42 degrees going up there. So I mean, it's cold, but it warms up as you get going. The problem is you don't want to start peeling layers off, so you're kind of stuck. And you're there for 2 hours and you're up pretty far up. And the biggest challenge is learning how to hold your bladder for that long, you know, because you're not going anywhere,
right?
You know, because remember, we're not just there from the time they say go, like we're up there before shooting beforehand and then afterwards. So it is quite a challenge because you want to have your coffee. You want to do, you know, your morning ritual to wake up at that ungodly hour. But, you know, it is though. But you know what? But going back to what you were saying about, because I didn't grow up here. I grew up in Iowa, as we all know, if we're watching. And I watched the Rose Parade on New Year's Day and did exactly what you said, going, oh, I was frozen in. And I just got how beautiful that is. And the Valley Hunt Club came up with this idea because a lot of them had moved from the East and Midwest out here. And they were like, we want to show off. Look at this. We have oranges that we can pick. We have flowers that are blooming. Let's do this. And that's how it all started back in 1890. I think about 1895, it had grown so much. They couldn't, you know, manage it anymore. So the Tournament of Roses was created. But I wanted to tell you, because once you start hosting something like this, there's so much tradition. It's just rich with information. So each year I find even more stuff I didn't know about. But one of the things that surprised me as a sports guy is the Rose Bowl didn't start, the game itself didn't happen until 1902. So people after the parade would have chariot races. There were like bronco riding demonstrations. They even had tug of war at that point. Right. This sort of disgusts me because as a football player, you never quit. But the game between was it Stanford? I'm trying to think of who was it, but it was 49 Michigan. It was Michigan and Stanford. It was 49-0, and they quit before the game was over. And they didn't have another game until I think 1912.
Oh yeah.
So,
yeah.
It really was. There's so many really fascinating, interesting stories about the Rose Parade. A lot of people never know. And getting a chance to see how those floats are put together up close and personal, how each seed, each tiny little seed is put in place and the manner that they're constructed, it is truly artwork. I'm in awe every single year that we get a chance to go view these up close and watch all these volunteers get into those warehouses and start building these things. And that all comes together at the very, very end.
It sure does. In the prep that you got to do has got to be significant. I mean, because everybody wants to be recognized on this really special day, sitting in the stands and then, you know, moving around. It's so cool to hear the family. Like, we were fortunate enough to be near a family of somebody that was in a marching band from another state.
Yeah.
They were so proud. Like, they were, tears were coming down. They were so proud that their kid was in that. Or, you know, just those different floats that are coming down and people that get to ride on those floats. Like, every part of that, there's so much pride that goes into it. And then you can tell the people of Pasadena that are part of this, they just puffed their chest for that day. They're like, yep, we do this. And the whole world sees it.
They tell a lot of the band members that are marching, or anybody really, they come from smaller towns, smaller communities. They all pay, they raise money to get themselves there. Mm-hmm. When they make that turn and head down Colorado Boulevard, they're a little bit elevated, and you can, if you're ever there, and you can look down and they will see probably close to 1 million people. I mean, it's that, because it's 5.5 miles long, and there are more people there than most people have in their hometowns. Yeah. And they're all lined in the streets up these massive scaffolding, you know, the seats, and they sometimes forget what they're doing, you know, because they come around and they just have this amazing view. So they remind, you know, the kids, because they're kids, and they get a chance to see this and do this. And it's a memory that they will always treasure. And there's stuff leading up to the parade where they have, you know, the bands get together and perform and things like that. So, and then there's also the LA Unified School District Band, which is an amazing, you know, there's a lot of homegrown stuff, but there's also a lot of international stuff that comes into play here too. Now this year, it's going to be interesting with COVID going on. In fact, I'm going to record something here just shortly. They're doing a little Rosebud mini virtual parade where people are locked in. So they're making their own miniature floats from home, as sort of like a fun competition, to keep, you know, the Rose Parade in mind. But I'm curious, because the tournament has to make up some pretty, you know, interesting decisions about how much international fair we'll have this year. I don't know. I hope everything is taken care of. I hope, you know, this thing gets settled and we want New Year's Day to be what we always know New Year's Day to be.
Like a coming back out party, you know, and also there's this fundraising that goes on for more affluent communities, for less affluent communities, that bring out these bands and so forth and so on. Which is great. Now, we're looking for this one picture, cause the parade we were at was the 2018 one. Do you remember the breakdown of that? I think it was the Chinese Heritage float that broke down.
Where the two boats came apart.
Yeah. Yep. Yeah. So we have the tow truck driver that came to get that, and it's exclusive footage that you're going to be interested in. But before Christine finds that, I'm going to tell you, I actually hold a Rose Bowl record, parade and game combined. Okay. So we're fortunate enough with the Roger Gowdy and Christine Gowdy to come out and be VIPs throughout the day. And VIP means there is plenty of food available to me. And I'm pretty sure, Mark, I came home at the end of the day and I wrote everything down. I think I went 3 scrambled egg plates, 2 French toast at the pre-tailgate outside. I went 3 hot dogs deep. And then at the food and the VIP at the game, I think I went 4 chicken plates, a couple more hamburgers, and maybe a combined Wolfgang Puck pizza. And so then I took that home with me and I said, you know what? This isn't anything to just write off. So I put it up on the big board at my house. And I said to my daughter, come look at what your dad did today.
And that's why you had to give up the lookalike John Elway, because you couldn't play football.
Yeah, part of it. Sure. Now, did we find it? Oh, you did. Okay. So look at this, Mark. You're going to this. So the float broke down, and look at our boy that was in charge. Okay. So this is the Tournament of Roses, Mark. This is seen around the world, and this is the guy that came and picked and he came to the rescue so that everybody could still march and share their dreams. You like that?
Apparently, the float wasn't the only thing that broke down.
You don't get that kind of stuff anywhere, but you know, from the top video podcast and the
what a moment that was, right? Like,
crazy. Just,
yeah, it was.
We're walking around it, and then the fans exited the stands because there was such a gap in everybody making the turn that it got kind of nuts that way.
That since Lisa and I started doing this, which it's such an honor to do. The first year we had it we were on January 2nd. Oh, a lot of people know this, but the parade is never held on a Sunday. In January 1st, our first year. January 1st was on a Sunday. And the reason for that is it's tradition way back early on when they had this, people would have their horses locked up out, you know, wrapped up outside of churches on Sunday. And the parade would go by and distract them. So they said, not going to do that. So they decided to push it. So if only on years when the first is on a Sunday, is it pushed to the second. So we were concerned about ratings, but, the other thing is, like, rarely does stuff like this happen. The parade is so timed out. Mm-hmm. Like, they will know as we're broadcasting if we have certain copy and if we have to get through this copy really quickly, it means they're just loading them in the shoot, like go, go, go. Right. And a band goes down. And if not, if something happens and then they have to pause, then you have to fill time. But when that happened, there was no communication between us and them going, what's going on? Why are they not going? And then you just have to, at that point, you just lean on your chops as a broadcaster and go with what's live, talk about what you see and what's happening. But there was, a lot of people just walked around it. And then people down the road thought the parade was over. So they just started coming up.
Coming out. Yeah. You know, I know when the sports stories with Denny Lennon will have earned their chops, and that'll be when I could back that story up with bringing an actual tow truck driver onto the show. Like if I brought him on right now, then I'd know we've arrived. Like that's that's our marker.
Right. Which end would you bring on?
Right. That's another good question. Damn it. I got to think these things through. Damn it. All right. Mark, if you'd like, I'd invite you to hang out for a second because we're going to do a commercial and then we're going to bring in the former head coach of Auburn University. Now, you're quite familiar with Midwest football and you remember Woody Hayes?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Well, remember how he was a little hot headed? That's the guy we're bringing on. So we thought it would be fun to bring him on. Yep. He's a hoot from the volleyball world. So we're going to go to break. And if you'll stick around, we'd appreciate it. But I understand if you got to get back to the family.
I got no place. I got a margarita. Where am I going? Come on.
I love it. That's why we do this. Okay. Oh, I'm stretching for the commercial. Wow. Are you? Yeah, in effect. Sure. All right, America, let's show the commercial.
Vámonos a Casablanca. Vámonos a Casablanca. La comida para la familia. Vámonos a Casablanca. Vámonos a Casablanca.
Sports Stories with Denny Lennon aims to bring its subscribers interesting, unique, and uplifting stories. You can find us at sportsstoriespodcast.com. We drop audio, video podcasts every Thursday and go live at 5 on YouTube 4 nights a week. That's Sports Stories with Denny Lennon.
That was the original commercial that set the world on fire. Awesome, right? Okay. I think we should go to... okay, let me preface this. Our boy Wade, coach, right? He's got a little bit of a hothead. Okay. Volatile is calling it easy. Now, do you remember when you had to duck and cover because we all worried about a nuclear war coming down? Okay, let's just say maybe some of his players thought the same way. Let's do his walkout video.
Now, here's a bit of public information left over from the 50s.
And Bert the Turtle was very alert. When danger threatened him, he never got hurt. He knew just what to do. He'd duck and cover. Duck and cover.
He did what we all must learn to do.
You
and you
and you
and you.
Just what to do. He'd duck and cover.
Okay, let's bring in the former head coach at Auburn University, the man who got him to the playoffs, the NCAAs. That's my boy, Wade Benson. Hi, Wade. Wait, he's got to unmute.
Sorry.
Wait, we're going to unmute you, Wade. Uh-oh. That wasn't inappropriate, was it, Wade?
That's probably appropriate.
Because, you know, everybody's got to have a walk-up video. And I don't, you know, I just want to make sure we're okay.
Oh, we're, you know, I'm fine, actually. Life is good.
Good. Depends. Hey, Depends. Meet Mark Steines. I know you guys briefly met yesterday in our audio check.
I had to wear it. I had to bring in the you and I hat.
You did wear the U and I hat, and I used to coach at Eastern Washington, which they're rivals big time, both top 10 perennial programs. And so I, you know, study that division a little bit, know the coaches and a lot of the ex-players from Eastern Washington, and they always had high things to say about that. Your conference and the Big Sky Conference are probably the two best conferences in that level of football. So a lot of fun watching when those guys went against each other in the playoffs.
Yeah, I agree. I agree 100%.
You you were two-time Big Sky Conference Coach of the Year, DB, the Benz.
Somebody had to be. It might as well be me, right?
Yes, that's right. So you know you worked your way to that spot, and that's an impressive that's impressive that you got those two. I don't know. Like you might have won the Big Sky Conference Coach of the Year a couple times, but my boy Mark up there, he's won some Emmys. Which of those Emmys do you like the best, Mark?
Oh gosh.
God, see, that's how we throw people off the show. And it doesn't matter if you've won four Emmys or you're an admiral in the Navy, you're going to get thrown off. And you don't know when it's coming. You just don't know. You don't know. And I'll tell you before, I'm like, yeah, it's a thing we do, blah, blah, blah. We throw you off the show. And then they still get thrown off. What do you think about that, Wade?
I think it's good because it gets me a little more airtime. And I think that's what people really want to hear.
No doubt. Yeah, there's no reason to listen to the guy from Entertainment Tonight that won four Emmys.
Not at all.
Right.
That's what I was wondering.
Yes, yes. Like, where's my shot? Yeah, understood.
By the way, Denny, you're wearing your UCLA football shirt, which everybody's forgotten about. but I do have my University of Hawaii women's volleyball.
Okay.
You know, which is a women's program. I'm just, you know, a winning program. I'm just shouting out to UH and former head coach Dave Soji, who's a good friend and every once in a while throws me some gear.
Okay, fair enough. Who's the strapping youngster in the picture next to you there?
Well, I mean, I was surprised that I took this down off the wall, but this with Mark.
You surprised yourself.
Yes, with Mark being on, I had to show a before and after pic of a young DeBenz and an older DeBenz. I didn't want it to be just Beauty and the Beast, you know, with Mark. So I had to show an earlier picture to know that there was a day that Bill Benson could strut.
Were you ever like recognized as like James Dean or something? Just like he was recognized as Mark Steines?
Well, unfortunately, recently I was going for a swim and at the club, and somebody came up to me and he said, "James Taylor." James Taylor.
Fair enough.
I said, "Okay, yeah, I'll go with it."
Yeah, fair enough.
Of course, that's an after, you know, scenario. But before, let's see. I think McFly. You remember McFly?
Yeah.
McFly was my deal because I used to slick my hair back a little bit when I had some.
Mm. Tell us a little bit about getting involved in coaching. I remember your very first day of high school coaching up in Oregon, and you rose the ranks all the way up to the SEC.
Well, yeah, you can tell that story here in a minute, which I think will be funny, but. Coming from the Northwest, I went to University of Oregon from St. Bernard's High School, where I had such a great volleyball experience. So went up there and ended up getting to the SEC, which was a blast. And I went there as an assistant coach for the first year. And as soon as I saw that they had, jets that we could fly on, just private deals for our volleyball team, and that they had 100,000 fans and 3-day, camping events prior to the games happening, I kind of figured I could recruit to the place. So I ended up getting the job the next year. We had a top 20 recruiting class right off the bat. And within 3 years, we made it to the NCAAs for the first time in Auburn history. And just had a lot of good memories. A lot of good memories in the SEC. Watched a lot of great sports. Have a lot of good stories about coaches and players along the way. So just a blast. Totally blessed. You know, had that experience.
We, you talked about the time when we were together in Portland, Oregon, and you had your first day of coaching a high school team, and I think we had a fun night out the night before. We experienced the road. And you said, DL, wake up. I got my first day of practice. I'm not quite sure what's going on here. And the fact of the matter is we got through it. I got up, I got off your couch, and we went and we figured out with St. Mary's. Is that who that was?
St. Mary's Academy.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yep. No, I think you ran the practice actually, because, you know, I played and I kind of went in there and, kind of won it, you know, as a player wanting to be a coach, but never coaching previously. It's kind of like, hey, Denny, you've got a couple years of experience on me here. Why don't you run the practice and I'll just kind of, you know, work my way through it. And so that was just a total blast. And, you know, having the old Venice boys up north for a little while was very cool.
Yeah, it was. All right, look, let's just get this out in the open. Why are you on the Sports Stories with Denny Lennon? Hopefully you'll be our correspondent for collegiate athletics. Why are you known as the Woody Hayes of collegiate volleyball?
Well, there's a lot of stories, but today, you know, we'll just probably stick with one. I was an assistant at Eastern Washington. We were at Montana State playing a former national team coach, Dave Gant's team. Heated rivalry. And, you know, match went five. We were just kind of up and coming. It was a big win for us. And jumped off the bench after the fifth game, looked over at the coaching staff and spouted, a few special words. And They ended up seeing it. The head coach kind of rushed over. He was 6'5". You know, I'm 6 foot. And we went kind of toe-to-toe. And the crowd at Montana State, which was probably 1,000 deep, started kind of coming onto the floor. And it was quite a little, meeting at the 50-yard line. It was almost Miami, Notre Dame, or, you know,
right.
It was close. But so funny, he went on and kind of tried to get me fired, for just kind of being a little bit overly competitive, maybe at the moment, you could say. But, hey, I'm from the Marina Peninsula, St. Bernard's High School. I mean, that's where they rear us.
Yes.
Okay. So, went to a Catholic school, but you know, come on.
We're up on the main street in Delray. Understood.
So, yeah, I figured they would understand, but obviously they didn't go to a Catholic school.
Yeah, they didn't. They didn't get that. So Wade William Benson, Bill Benson, as some of us know you by, DeBenz. I got somebody I'd like to bring back in, another coaching colleague, somebody who's been on the show a few times before on both Tuesdays, Wednesdays, and even once on a Friday. Let's bring them in now to the show to say hello to you, Benz. He's the several time state champion
and
from Loyola High School.
Action in three. Hold on. I'm going to action in three.
Benz, part of the very first interview. Well, technically the second, the first real interview. And look at this shot. Good form. It just doesn't go down. Good follow-up. But, you know, that's our boy right there, DeBenz. I know who you know I'm talking about. MB on the show. Come on in, MB.
He was here. He just left.
Oh, where'd he go? He got mad because we showed him missing that shot.
Oh, he's back.
Oh, he's back. Hold on. He's back. Hold on. Let's bring him in, Wade. MB.
I'm here.
Hi. Okay, say hi to Wade.
Hi, waiter.
What's up, buddy? How's it going?
I'm good, man. How are you doing?
I'm doing good. I didn't know that you were going to be able to get a legend from the high school boys' ranks coming onto the program. Somebody with his pedigree. It's pretty impressive. I'm very impressed.
Mm-hmm. I got all kinds of connects. Mike, you don't get mad because Wade. We know how Wade might blow up, but you're not upset when we show that shot, are you, MB?
Of course I am. Are you kidding me? I mean, the form is great, but the ball doesn't go in the hoop. So of course I'm going to be upset. Okay. That's all. I need to hit the first shot. And then when you have people that have never played the sport of basketball before go out and make their first shot, that bothers me.
Yeah.
We can attest to that. We've had our conversations about being competitive, holding ground, doing what we think is right. And sometimes that bites us in the butt sometimes. And that's just the way we are. I mean, the way I've been wired.
That's the hoop right out back of the 7428 studio where we do our interviews, Ben's. And so anybody who does the interview here at the home studio has got to take the shot and then walk it in.
Nice.
And, you know, so some make it, some don't. And like, we're not here to make fun of anybody. We're just here to record history.
Hey, it was in and out. At least it wasn't an air ball.
Yeah. I feel like you guys can see me, but you're not. So I'm making all these expressions on the I don't think I'm on camera yet, but I'm sure the audio is there, correct?
You're there.
Oh, yeah,
So I have to back up. You know, we talk about the Woody Hayes of volleyball. I've got a story. So Ben's and I go way back to his high school days. That's where I first met Wade, through Denny and my brother Danny and Ray and everybody. But, man, Wade got us into a lot of trouble one night at a nightclub called Dylan's.
Oh, you're hurting me with this story.
And, you know, we thought we were doing pretty well that night. It was in Westwood, if I stand to be corrected.
It was.
And for some weird reason, we had about six or seven of us, and we were dressed to the hilt and a great time until this group of guys confronted.
From the Middle East, my friend. From the Middle East. Don't forget that.
Okay.
You can't, who would? Who would forget that?
Okay.
Not me.
And I don't know how it all happened, but the next thing I know, they are jawing at us, and they take a pop and hit Wade. Wade takes one for about seven of us right into the eye, and it was like, holy cow. I'm sure you remember. They got thrown out. We didn't. But someone, he either looked at one of their friends wrong or said something like, what are you looking at, dude? And yep. It was game on. So
it was a stare off, a classic stare off, right? Back in the high school days.
Yeah.
We had snuck in Sullivan, buddy Sullivan, took us to our first frat party. We had a few, underage cocktails,
mm-hmm.
and ended up getting into Dylan somehow. And yeah, we had a little stare down going, and all I remember is a lot of fists coming my way and looking around for the help.
Oh, yeah.
And I don't know if I saw any help by Michael Boley. I wonder if Michael Boley went the other way or if he ran in.
I think he was on.
He was going to get help. He was going to get help, Wade.
I appreciate that. Appreciated that. Four or five lumps on the back of the head later, I was just fine. Everything went well, but I appreciate you mentioning that.
Yeah.
And I do have a question for both of you. Was it 81 at Bernard's? Was that senior year or 82?
82 was my senior year, but 81 would have been the fall. So 82 senior year was the first official high school season for St. Bernard. I think 81 was a unofficial season. We weren't attached to any, we couldn't make playoffs or anything, but 82, we were official as a CIF school.
So here's my question for everybody listening or anybody around the Los Angeles area that knows sports. On that team that we followed, by the way, right, at St. Bernard's High School basketball, a legendary team,
right,
with five Pac-12 players on the roster,
plus others,
as well as, people won't remember this guy, maybe a guy named Sticks,
Robert Halling.
Oh, okay, who ended up going to Wyoming. So we had the Knox brothers. One who went to UW, one who went to Oregon State. We had Corey Gaines, who goes to UCLA and is now a prominent women's coach.
Mm-hmm.
We had, was it Anderson? It was the other guard who went to Cal.
Chris Washington.
Chris Washington goes to Cal.
Thompson.
Who else? I mean, are you Bobby kidding?
Thompson? Was it Bobby Thompson?
Yeah. Bobby Thompson, Arizona State.
Arizona State. And they didn't even win state.
I was called up in 81 to that team from the JV team as a junior. I had to play JV because I was punished for playing football. And we went deep into the playoffs. And then the following year, they win section, but bowed out of state. And look, the guy who built the program, Donovan Green, was a good coach. He was a good fundamental coach and so forth. But I saw firsthand that, you know, sometimes the moment got a little big.
Because now, I mean, you can barely even put a team together like that. You have Sierra Canyon, you know, has everybody and their mother on that team, right? They didn't even get top 10 nationally.
Mike Boley, how many CIF finals has your team made it to?
Shoot.
Really?
Nine or 10.
And you've won what, seven?
Six.
Six. So you're 6-4, 6-3?
Yeah, 6-3 or 4, yeah.
See, my boy Mike here, he's an in-game coach. He can both build the program and then within the game can change a little strategy, get a couple things going, get you over the top. That wasn't what Donovan Green was doing at the time. Now, I don't want to speak ill of Donovan Green. I'm just saying, like, he knew how to run a program, but yeah. When it came to those big games, wasn't his forte.
Clearly with 5 or 6 D1, yeah. I mean, that team was stacked.
They should have hung like 4 or 5 banners.
Oh, that was – but how fun was it all those times so we would be – can you remember the song in the back of the truck?
Yes.
In the back of the truck on the way to the game.
I got it. Going to Nogales.
Which one was it?
Nogales.
Okay, I thought it was Steely Dam.
Going to Nogales to see the great Vikings play.
Okay.
All right. So, Wade, fill us in because Mike is a longtime listener and a multi-time contributor. So he's got a vested interest in where Sports Stories goes. Fill us in on what kind of correspondent duties you're going to fulfill as we move forward with the show. Like, you know, I know you attend an awful lot of collegiate athletics, if not high school, and we're going to call our collegiate correspondent. So tell us how you're going to fulfill that role.
Very excited for the opportunity, by the way, Denny, and excited to see the podcast get bigger and bigger. But my son and I go a lot. My son's name is Brady. He's 16. We go a lot to any of the big time high school football, basketball, volleyball, baseball. We go everywhere and we go around. And I know a lot of college coaches and have some contacts and so forth from my coaching background, both in the South and on the West Coast. So we zip off everywhere. An example is going to be like, we're going to go to the Ohio State Oregon game where I went to college. But that's going to be canceled. I have some friends that could get us in there. And then we're going to Orlando or the Gonzaga, Auburn, a bunch of other teams, basketball tournament. And so really what I'm going to try to do is hook us up with these people in college and high school, be able to get some interviews with them throughout, maybe like a Mark Few from Gonzaga basketball or Killian Tilly, who's just going to be drafted hopefully in the first or second round, or, you know, Dave Soji over in the islands, you know, prominent volleyball guy. So just, you know, a bunch of interesting stories along the way from major high school situations or college contests. And even we, you know, I even go international on occasion to be able to go see some things. So yeah, could be very interesting. A lot of fun.
Any chance that you'll get, like, you'll be a correspondent trying to get an interview, you get kicked out like you did coaching either collegiate or club volleyball?
I'm gonna try my best. there's no question about that. So I don't think I'm gonna have to try real hard, but you know, so I think it's gonna be worth watching because I don't mind asking the tough questions.
that's important. You were okay with the walk-up video? Did you like it?
Oh, absolutely.
Okay.
Yeah, it's great.
Good. Yeah, I thought it was solid.
Hey, before I go, I need to throw him a little credit here.
Okay.
The Benz had a decent jump shot. I don't know if you remember playing Denny in those.
Oh yeah.
In those nighttime games that we just talked about, Wade and Marina, Wade could play. But he also had the temper where, if he didn't – I was the ball hog, but he definitely had game. There's no doubt. Wade had game, and I need to give him props on that because I think that was his first love was the game of hoops. He was a very good athlete. Tennis, volleyball, basketball, he did it all. And I think that's why he fit in so well with us because we all did that. We were all pretty good athletes. And so he fit right in. He was always such a joy to have around. He made us laugh. We have all these nicknames from him. And to this day, we still, him and I have something in common, which is so nice to be able to bounce off of him back and forth. So I appreciate our friendship. I want to tell you that I welcome you to the show. I look forward to seeing you more and more, Wado, as we get this thing going. But you look great. He's also a cancer survivor. He beat it. And that needs to be said, too. That's awesome. He's a fighter. And no pun intended on that one. But he's certainly is a joy to have and be around, and I'm just proud to call him my friend.
You're very nice, MB. With too that, nice. Look, there's a question on the screen for you, Wade. Let's see. I got a bunch of girls asking me if DeBenz is single. Any thoughts?
wait. There we go.
Yeah, right. Either guy would.
No, I think it's this guy they're talking about. This guy's changing right here.
MB is on point. DB, DeBenz, I can't wait to keep you in the loop on these things. And it's going to be fun to keep sending it to you.
Going to be a blast. And I see Danny Bowley's talks that we played in the Gillis together. That's one of his little... And I want to tell Danny hello. Can't wait to see you again. I see Ray Castro. Oh, see, Ray said, he's sang in the back truck, Blackwater by Doobie Brothers. I told you, Mike.
There it is. DeBenz, that's Ray. That's Box Cobbler Entertainment. He comes strong with those morphed kind of characters at the end. And he's the guy who's behind all our commercials. So. Before we break the record for the longest show ever.
Yeah. DL, can I wipe myself?
Yeah, go ahead, Mike. You've earned that.
All right. Later.
DeBenz. Wait, you got to wipe. There he is. DeBenz, last question. This is too obvious. I'm just going to go ahead and wipe you. Okay. That got too obvious. Last question. Damn it. I got to, Margarita's kicking in. All right. That was fun, right? Mark Steines, freaking awesome. I love learning more about the Rose Bowl parade, history of that. It's brilliant. And also just his background was great. So Mark will be a frequent guest, I hope, on the show. Mark, awesome.
There's a lot of people asking for him to come back. And
yes. Also, I know he's got further interests, including he's a terrific photographer. And so we'll dive into much more with him. But as you can see, we already went an hour 20 in, and we can go an hour with Mark easy. So we'll look forward to doing that. We'll keep him in the loop. All right, we got lots of stuff coming up next week. We keep bringing the programming. I think that was fun. That didn't suck. That was fun. Okay, Wade Benson's hilarious. All right, let's go.
Did he ever answer the question whether he was single or not?
He's not single.
Oh, there's some people that really want to know. I've already gotten an email and the text from
him. Wade is...
I'm just saying.
Wade is committed to several things, including volleyball. All right. All right, we'll see you next week.
I've just seen a face. I can't forget the time or place we met, but she's the girl for me. I want all the world to see we met. Had it been another day, well, I might have looked the other way, and I would never been aware. And as it is, I'll dream of her tonight. Da 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 da. Falling, yes, I have fallen, and she keeps calling me back again. See you next week.
Sports Stories with Denny Lennon is supported by the AAU. Find a local event and join at aausports.org. And remember, you can catch your favorite amateur sports live stream, replays, and highlights at ballertv.com. Sports Stories, along with East Bay, supports the Heroes Movement, a nonprofit that bridges the gap from mental or physical therapy to getting strong again through strength and conditioning workouts. This free service is available for any veteran of the United States Armed Forces. Visit heroesmovementusa.org for more information. Sports Stories, along with thousands of people across the country, also supports the My Stuff Bags Foundation, a nonprofit that provides traumatized children with new belongings and new hope. Learn more at mystuffbags.org. Sports Stories with Denny Lennon is a production of Sports Stories, Inc. and is available on Apple Podcasts and YouTube or wherever you listen and watch. Don't forget to subscribe, rate, and give us a review. It really helps spread the word. You can find all our social media links, archives, and other info on our website at sportsstoriespodcast.com. Special thanks to the John R. Wooden Course and Wooden's Wisdom. Original music for Sports Stories is courtesy of Lennon Music Productions. Original images by Sienna Lennon Photography. Sports Stories is produced by Christine Jimbo and Marley Rice. Sports Stories is edited by Bob McCall. Additional staff include Ray Castro, Teresa Dolan, Jake Downey, Carlos Haro, and Buck Magic Lennon. Kick it out, Buck!
Yeah, kick it out! Kick it out! Yeah, buddy! Way to kick it out! Good job!